Hi, FGA. Thank you so much for this opportunity to share with you. I would have loved to have been with you in person this weekend, but I think under the circumstances, it's good that I can share with you on video. And I want to thank Pastor Chris, Mayen, and the whole team at FGA for this opportunity. And I know you've been going through the series, Honest to God. And today I want to really talk to you about honest conversations. And I'll be sharing a little bit from what I'm going through at the moment. But our text for today is Luke 15. And this is the story of the prodigal son. Many of us know this story about the prodigal who came to the younger son, went to his father, and pretty much asked for the inheritance. And in the Jewish culture, when a son comes to the father, I suppose maybe in any culture, while the father is still alive and says, "Can I have my inheritance?" He's saying, "Dad, you are dead to me." So this was quite shocking. And it's really interesting to know when Jesus shared this parable with the people who were around him, they were the sinners, the tax collectors, but also the rabbis, the teachers of religious law who were listening in. And so this would have really struck, this parable would have struck everybody who was listening. And many of you know the rest of the story, that he took the inheritance, he went off to a far land, spent all the inheritance, all the money on wild living, parties, and all sorts of worldly lifestyle. And he reached a point where he had no money left. And the situation got so bad that he ended up looking after pigs. And as again, in the Jewish culture, if you're working with pigs, right, suddenly pigs are not kosher at all. And what's worse was that he was eating pig's food. And he comes to a realization and he wakes up to himself. And this is where I want to read from Luke 15, verse 17. It says, "When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, 'At home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare. And here I'm dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant.'" Now, this was a very real wake-up call for this guy. He came to his senses and he realized that even the hired servants ate better food and had a better life than what he was experiencing. Now, I don't know whether you've had very honest conversations and realizations in your life, but recently, some of you may know, and I want to thank FGA and Pastor Chris for praying for me. A few weeks ago, I actually, my glasses broke. So the bridge on my nose broke. And I decided, like the ad says, to go to Specsavers. So I went to Specsavers and they said, "Come and do the eye test." So as I was doing the eye test, when they covered my right eye, I was having trouble reading on my peripheral vision, you know, the letters on the eye chart. And I cut a long story short, I did peripheral eye tests and they said, "Your eyes are fine. They're all healthy. They're good." So they sent me to an eye specialist and the eye specialist said, you know, they repeated the test and they found that I was, something was impinging on my optic nerve. And it was at that point I began to realize this is something pretty serious. And so I went to do the MRI, which wasn't a fun thing because the doctor stuffed it up and I had to do it twice. And they found a 21 millimeter pituitary gland tumor or cyst growing on my pituitary gland. Now, when you hear reports like that, you're like, wow, okay, right? I got a brain tumor. And obviously, it can shake your world. It can rattle you. And I suppose I was laughing a bit because, you know, the ad should have gone to Specsavers. Well, I did. And it's probably saved me a lot of pain, a lot of, a lot of worry. But this is this whole diagnosis, I suppose I'm quite prophetic. So I knew certain things were already happening. And I want you to see that God was already ahead of me, pun intended. Even I think 2 weeks before that, I had a dream about two snakes. There was a python that I was fighting, and I managed to cut off its head. And as soon as I cut off its head, I knew I had the victory. But then a second red-bellied black snake appeared, and I cut off its head too. And I was going, what on earth? You know, I just killed one snake and another snake appeared. And it was so interesting that in this dream, often when you have dreams about snakes, it's to do with a spiritual attack, witchcraft of some sort. And I knew I had the victory. And then probably 2 weeks ago, I went to a conference and I caught up with a pastor that I hadn't seen, you know, since pre-COVID. And he had a brain tumor, a very serious one at the back of his brain. And doctors said, you know, you could lose memory, you could lose speech and so on. But it was amazing because he's recovered so well, hasn't lost a thing. And his name was Jonathan. The very next day, I met a businessman from Sydney who moved up here, and our families were having lunch together, and he didn't know my situation at all. And out of the blue, he begins to share about his older brother that also had a brain tumor that was about to, you know, they said, oh, he's going to lose memories and all sorts of things. And he too is totally fine, didn't lose anything. And the amazing thing is his brother's name is Graham. The two names, those are my names. Jonathan, it's my first name, and my middle name is Graham. And I thought, God, isn't it interesting? God can encourage us, right, even before these things happen. And God is really in control. So there are times, you know, when I really want to thank Pastor Chris as a dear friend and Mayenne. Of course, I have cried. I've, you know, had those times where I'm listening. I'm a worshiper. I love, you know, I'm a musician. You guys know that. Been singing Waymaker a lot. And there's some nights I was listening to Waymaker and just in tears worshiping the Lord. And I think you've been looking at the Psalms. Some of you have written Psalms, a cry from your heart. And I think it's so important to go before God in these times when we have these honest conversations with God and even honest conversations with ourselves. And I want to thank Pastor Chris because I said, Chris, if anything happens to me, I want you to, you know, advise, be part of the process, advise our board, advise our leadership here at ICC. And I just love Chris and Mayenne, and just thank you so much for your support. But I'm believing for healing. And some people are asking me, you know, what's going on? And, you know, so they found this 21 millimeter growth on my pituitary gland. And I had to go see a brain surgeon. And quite honestly, the scariest moment of this whole process, I've got so much peace. So many people are praying for me. I don't want too much peace, otherwise I might rest in peace. But the scariest moment was I was in the doctor's lounge, and it was beautiful. And when I went into his room with my wife, Deborah, he opened the door, scariest moment, the room was the messiest room I've ever seen. And at that moment, I almost had like a panic attack, quite honestly. And I was like, oh, I gasped, and I was like, oh no, right? This is the guy that might be operating on my brain. And, you know, there were journals everywhere. There were, you know, bags on the floor, charts on the floor, you know, books and journals stacked up everywhere. I know there are a lot of doctors in FGA. Doctors, please keep your rooms clean, please, especially if you're a brain surgeon. And the funniest thing, I shared this in my church, and one of the Connect pastors said that, you know, it's okay that they're very messy, you know, because Eugene, our tech pastor, right? You know, his room is pretty messy. And can I tell you, this brain surgeon's room is pretty messy, almost as messy as Eugene's. And this Connect pastor said, although Eugene's room is messy, do you know what? He's very good at fixing things. So I was like, yeah, you're right. So praise God, I've got, you know, a top professor working as my brain surgeon. And I thought, well, you know, God is good. So I'm actually scheduled for the operation on the 8th of May and would appreciate your prayers. So these things, I don't know what you're going through, but maybe it's not brain surgery, but it's maybe something else in our lives where we've been through situations that cause us to come to our senses and have this very real, honest-to-God moment. And this son decides to return home to his father. And can I continue? And from verse 20, it says, so he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him and kissed him. His son said to him, Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy of being called your son. But his father said to the servants, quick, bring the finest robe in the house, put it on him, get a ring for his finger, sandals for his feet, kill the calf we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast. For this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now he is found. So the party began. Now, I want you to notice that Jesus said, if you have seen me, you've seen the Father. And I want us to look a little bit at the Father, because when we have these honest conversations with God, when we are faced with challenges and, you know, situations, it could be a financial crisis, whatever crisis, a relational crisis, how many of us turn to God? I love the fact that this son returned, decided to return home to his father. He was replaying in his mind over and over again. You know, you could see that his heart had changed. And he was trying to, you know, Father, he rehearsed his speech. Father, I've sinned against both heaven and you. I'm not worthy to be called your son. But I want you to see that the father doesn't rebuke him. But I want you to see the father's response. We know that he embraces him, kisses him. But even before this, I want to explain to you what is going on. Because in the Jewish culture, when a son or a member of the family takes the inheritance or does something like this and leaves the home and brings shame upon the family, if that person, that family member tried to come back, the village would do what was called a kazaza. Everybody say kazaza. Right? It's not a Lion King term, right? I know Pastor Chris loves Disney, but kazaza, there's a kazaza ceremony. Before this family member could come back, the members of the village would go almost to the outskirts of the village. They would take pottery and they would break the pottery, the pots, right, in front of this person, throw it down at their feet. And the broken pottery speaks of the broken relationship that this family member has with the family. And what they're saying is, we cut you off. You are not welcome back. You are a shame to your family. And here the father, right, this is the older father, he, you know, in Jewish culture, it's very shameful for the older father for the elders to expose their legs. You can imagine with his robe, he would have gathered up his robe, even exposing his legs. And he sees his son afar off, right at the outskirts of the village, and he runs to him. Why? Because the father is trying to stop this kazaza ceremony from happening. He runs. He takes the shame upon himself, exposing his own legs. And he runs to the son while he's still far off. And he immediately, filled with love and compassion, he embraces and kisses him. Now, my brothers and sisters, this is the love of our Father. Isn't it amazing that our Father God comes running to us? God sees our hearts. And you know, you've heard the messages that God is big enough to take whatever we can throw at Him. In fact, as I said, God is already ahead of us. And God is there, filled with love, filled with compassion. And I think it's amazing that God sees our repentant heart. God, in fact, sees the humble heart. In fact, Scripture says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Grace to the humble. And you can see the humility in the Son returning back. Now, I want to encourage us. You may not be a prodigal, or you may. Last week in church, I was sharing this message, and there was a prodigal in our midst. He hadn't been to church for years, and this is an older guy, and probably in his late 30s, early 40s, and his mom was there, and he said, "Mom, I want to go to church." And I don't know whether you're in that situation, but whatever it is, whatever we are facing, in our honesty, let's turn to God. So I just thank God that He loves me. I thank God in that. And it's amazing that the Father immediately calls for the robe, tells the servants, get the finest robe. Often the finest robe is reserved for the son of inheritance. You know, like Esau was the older one. He was the son with the birthright. And you know the stories of, you know, Jacob and the technicolor coat, the favored son, right? And the new robe, the best robe, speaks about our identity. In fact, in covenantal exchange, even David exchanged tunics with Jonathan. And it is a covenantal act. So if I, for example, wore, say Pastor Chris has a Disney coat and he gives me his Disney jacket, right? And I wear it, people might see me from the back and somehow, you know, I'm a lot, obviously wider, a bit shorter, okay, fatter. I can blame the tumor for that because it affects metabolism. Anyway, if you saw me wearing Pastor Chris's Disney jacket, you might say, "Hey, isn't that Chris? Is that Chris?" Maybe your peripheral vision isn't that good. You say, "Is that Chris?" You see, there's an identity that's there. The two are confused. They become one almost. You go, "Isn't that Chris? Is that Chris?" Right? And likewise, we have a new identity in Christ. We are welcomed back into the family of God. The second thing is the signet ring. And we know about this is the ring of authority. God gives us authority over situations. When Pharaoh, right, and Joseph, Pharaoh gave his ring, signet ring, to Joseph. He said, "Joseph, you are second in charge. Everyone must listen to you, right? You're in charge of leading us through these 7 years of prosperity and then 7 years of famine. There's nobody higher, only me." So the ring of authority, God gives us the ring of authority. And I'm going to say a bit more about that. And then the sandals. The sandals speak about ownership, and you can see it in the book of Ruth when Boaz, the kinsman redeemer, gives his sandals, right, as a covenant token. He says, "I am going to redeem. this land. I'm going to redeem my new bride, right? Ruth. And so there's an exchange that happens there that speaks about ownership and inheritance. And finally, killing the fattened calf. That's covenantal. When God made the covenant with Abraham, he puts Abraham to sleep. He cuts the bull in two, right? The heifer in two, the two halves. And, you know, I was talking to this about this with my kids. And I said, what is this a picture of, right? You've got two halves and you've got the blood red trench in the middle. And my daughter Zara, you know, said, and Ethan said, that's like a wedding, right? The red carpet with the groom side and then the bride side. And who cuts the covenant? The husband cuts the covenant. He's there at the altar. And God cuts the covenant with us, right? He puts Abraham to sleep and he passes through the red, the blood. In other words, what he's saying is, if I ever break my vows, if I ever break my promise to you, may the same happen to me. And this is why I think as a household of faith, it's so important to understand the importance of covenant, because there should not be any divorce. God permitted divorce because of hardened hearts. Church, can I encourage us? Let's soften our hearts. Let's humble our hearts before God and be honest and turn to Him. So I want to encourage us that God has given us a new identity. God has restored us. And can I say that, you know, it's very hard to change just your behaviors and making changes in your life if you don't first understand that there's a change of identity. You're no longer a slave, right? We're no longer in darkness. We are sons and daughters of the living God. And when we understand that we don't have to follow our old Adamic nature. In fact, Galatians 5 says there are two natures at war in you. You have the old nature, which is based on the first Adam, and then the second Adam, Christ. And Christ is the second Adam. And the amazing thing is that these two natures are at war. But if we allow the Spirit of God to control us, we will not satisfy the old wicked desires. In fact, we'll begin to live for righteousness. And I want to encourage us that as sons and daughters of God, let's take up that authority. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 3, I've been meditating on this. It says very clearly that we are seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. In fact, it says, all praise to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ. Now, I want you to see this, and I'm going to get Eugene to help me with this because I want you to see that we are in Christ. But where is Christ seated? He is above every principality, every power. Ephesians 1 tells us that. Now, imagine Eugene. Where's Eugene? There he is. Eugene is Jesus, right? And I want you to go up. Thank you, Eugene. He's a trained professional, so he knows what he's doing. Now, Christ is seated above all principalities, all powers, all the challenges, the crises, all the situations we may be going through. And it says that we have been blessed with every spiritual blessing. Now, I believe that given that signet ring, we have the authority to lay hold of spiritual blessings. And these blessings, we pray, right? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, so I believe that there are so many blessings in Christ, blessings of, you know, salvation, of eternal life, forgiveness of sins, blessings of healing, blessings of breakthroughs that we might need to lay hold of. But many times I found that you realize that sin can trip us up. We get so distracted in our prayers. And I want to share the Daniel 10, 12 principle with you. Thanks, Eugene. I don't know what you're in Daniel chapter 10. Daniel prays and he fasts and prays, and it takes 21 days for the answer to come to him. And I was talking to Eugene about upload speeds. Now, normally upload speeds are pretty slow and download speeds are pretty fast. And I call this, you know, we have NBN plans, NBN 50, 70 or 100, whatever it is. And I want to call this the Daniel 10, 12 plan. Because Daniel, when the angel came to him after the 21 days, he said, "Daniel, you are dearly loved. We heard your prayer on day one, but it took 21 days, right, for the answer to come, for the breakthrough to come. Why? Because there was resistance in the spiritual realm. Now, Ephesians 6 tells us that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but we wrestle against, right, evil, dark, demonic powers in the heavenly realms. But I want us to understand that sometimes when we pray, the upload speed is very fast. Daniel was heard from day one, but it took 21 days. The download speed was a little bit slow, right? What would have happened if Daniel stopped praying, gave up fasting on day 7? Or maybe day 12? Or maybe day 19? I don't know. Maybe the breakthrough wouldn't have come. But it's very important that we persevere. Hebrews 12:1 says, "Let us run with endurance the race God has set before us." So there are some things we need to lay hold of and we need to endure. Amen? So I want us to put on every piece of God's armor so that we can resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after the battle, we will still be standing firm. Stand your ground, putting on the full armor of God, the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, and so on. Now, a lot of people, we not only have to persevere, but we have to pursue. We've got to press in on things, particularly in prayer. Hebrews 12:14 says, "Pursue peace with all people and pursue holiness, without which no one will see the Lord." Now, a lot of people think that sometimes, right, even with holiness, I'm already holy in Christ. Correct. We are already one body in Christ. In fact, we shouldn't allow divisions because we're already members of one body. Likewise, we have positional holiness. We are holy in Christ. Now, let me illustrate this for you. How do you pursue holiness? Now, Pastor Chris and Mayen have been married 26 years. Now, even in year 1, year 10, year 12, year 26, they are married, right? They've always been married in that sense. They cannot be more married, right, than what they were even on day 1 of their marriage. But imagine if Pastor Chris, right, how does he pursue his marriage? He could buy flowers for Mayen every day for the next 21 days, right? And he writes love letters, beautiful psalms, poetry, right? "How lovely art thou." And every day he's, you know, cooking, all right? That's a miracle. And he's doing the washing. He does that. The cleaning, taking out the rubbish and writing beautiful, you know, taking her on dates for the next 21 days. You can see that he is working, he is striving, he is making every effort in pursuit of his marriage. Likewise, God wants us. Yes, we are already holy, but we can pursue God in these things. So I want to encourage us. The Bible says that, you know, without faith, it is impossible to please God. And what is faith? What is faith? Faith is the hypostasis of things hoped for. Hupostasis means this very quickly. It is the confidence, it's the assurance, right? It is the title deed. And I don't know about you, but because of my weight, there are certain chairs that I look at and I go, I don't think that chair is going to take my weight, right? But these chairs that we bought many years ago, tested them, I have confidence that this chair can take my weight. I have hupostasis that this chair can take my weight. Here we go, right? I sat on another chair last week and there was a, you know, one of the student chairs and it just went crack, crack, crack. I go, ooh, okay, be careful of that chair. This chair, I have no problem with. Amen? It takes my weight. Now, that's wonderful. But can I illustrate something else? And I'm going to need Eugene's help again with this one. Because many times, yeah, having faith in a chair, confidence is fine. And many of us have the faith of God. We can believe for healing and breakthrough. But can I describe sort of what I'm going through? And I think many of us go through at times, if we're honest to God. It's more like the trust, not the trust chair, but the trust fall. We know God is there to catch us, right? But here comes the thing. Eugene, do you trust me? I don't know. He's a bit nervous and hopefully I'll catch him. But here goes. Maybe arms a bit out. Okay. Go for it, Huge. Got him. Okay. Wow. Okay. Back injury. Sometimes the trust fall, there is that tipping point where we're falling, but I know God is there, but it's just in that point of letting go where we need to trust God. And this morning, I want to encourage us. The Lord, our Father, is there for us. We can put our trust in Him. And I want to thank you for all your prayers, for all your concern for me. Please pray for me. And I really believe that no matter, can I pray for you, that God will break through. Let's lay hold. Let's take authority. And let's not, you know, I, as I said, I'm a worshiper. I want to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. I'm not thanking God for the tumor, but I praise God because in some situations, I've had other friends, man, they've caught it, you know, when things were a lot worse, when their vision was almost gone. So I thank God this is caught early. And I'm just so grateful for all the love and support. But can I just pray for you as we come to this time and we conclude and we come to this time of ministry? Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, I thank you, Holy Spirit, that as a household of faith, as your children, O God, Lord, that you are in control of every situation. And Father, we thank you, Lord God, that, Lord, that you are our rock. You are our deliverer. And Lord, even at this time, you are our peace. I declare shalom. The peace that I have, Father, I release shalom over my brothers and sisters at FGA. No matter what they are going through, Father, with challenges, with relational situations in the family, Father, some might be praying for their prodigal sons or daughters, praying for family or for friends. Father, no matter what we are facing right now, I declare the peace of God. And in the name of Jesus, we take up the authority that we have. And Father, we pray from an elevated position in Christ as the ecclesia. Lord, we pray, whatever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever we loose in heaven shall be loosed on earth. So, Father, I bind every attack. I bind every influence of the enemy in the name of Jesus. We take authority. And, Father, we loose the blessings of God. Blessings of peace, blessings of righteousness, blessings of healing. You are Yahweh Rapha. Lord, you are Emmanuel, God with us. You are Shalom, the God of peace. And Lord, I thank you for your name, the name Yeshua, the name above every other name. Lord, that you are I am. And Lord, that you are my deliverer and you are my savior. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you, FGA.